Well, first of all, I'd like to thank Jim Fay for a fantastic job with his crew producing this amazing event and really backing him up here all those nights away from home. And tremendous thanks to the Chases, to my wonderful friends, Andy and Rachel, and of course to Sam and Lucy are here tonight. They rescued my youngest son, our younger son, Hayden. I was a class of 10. And of course, Alistair Arnot here, who is my producer for this event, class of 2028. In fact, when we were at the fundraising event last year in Boston, they said, "Why are you leaving so early?" And I said, "Well, Alistair doesn't have any other 28s to talk to." So I, as a physician and a journalist, I really spent my life advocating for many of the values you're talking about here, you really for tremendous equality and for most of the disadvantaged peoples around the world. I had reported from both of the Gulf Wars, the Rwandan genocide, most of the wars in Africa, many civil wars around the world. And after I'd left NBC, the challenge was, how do you keep young people engaged and interested in so many of the tragedies and important events around the world? Of course, the obvious choice was to become Dr. Danger. So, in fact, when I used to come on campus here, the show was on the air, and all the kids were referred to me as Dange. So this was our first episode here, which was in Somalia. When the premiere came around, people were wild. They couldn't believe a place like this existed, completely lawless. So this man on the left is the most successful pirate in recent history, David. He actually stole a Saudi Arabian oil tanker and received a $2.5 million ransom for it. I actually got into a lot of trouble here at Eaglebrook because I then wrote a letter saying that I had hoped that parents would donate to the annual fund. And if they didn't, they made an offer to invest in these pirate vessels where, although it might seem unethical and somewhat immoral, there would be a tremendous return for the annual fund unless we dug deep for the school that we all loved. This is coming out of Rocket Alley in Somalia. Rocket Alley because there's so many incoming missiles. I'm looking out of the back of a CH-47 U.S. Army helicopter. And here we have incoming and outgoing. Here's our tail gunner shooting furiously at the ground. We have an Apache warship overhead, and it reminds me of one of Churchill's greatest quotes, which is, "There's nothing more exhilarating than being fired at without effect." I mean, you don't get hit. And at the end, the gunner said, "Would you like to take the last few shots?" And I said, "Would I?" And I always tell people, if they say they are truly supporting the troops in the field, it's not true unless you've been out there and fired a few rounds with them. Right after 9/11, I was the chief medical correspondent at the Today Show, Dateline, all those shows, and I went to them and I said, "You know, I majored in Islamic history, I speak Arabic, Swahili, a variety of languages. I'd like to cover this war on terror." And they go, "Knock yourself out." So my first interview after 9/11 was with the Taliban. So this is right on the border with Afghanistan. This is a fellow named Zaif, who is their key minister. And I said, "Why do you guys hate us so much?" And they said, "Well, let's start with the First Crusade." So it was a long memory of dislike for the Western world. This is the invasion of Iraq, and this is our crew here. This is the Purple Foxes. We were the very first element into Iraq during the war. This is with U.S. Special Forces out on the Afghan-Pakistani border here. It's a Special Forces Group 3. It's a 50-caliber submachine gun. For those of you who have not yet had small arms familiarization here at Eaglebrook. And this is an interesting picture. This is the 28th Cash Hospital. You know, many people, when I listen to these speeches and have, you know, heard so many wonderful talks over the years here, wonder, you know, what can I possibly do? How can I possibly help? I'm one single individual. So I had been at our hotel in the morning. This young woman came up, about 22 years old, looked like a surfer. And she said, "I'm going to go out and save some lives this day." Was a member of big boards like Save the Children and the UN High Commission for Refugees. I reckon, you know, how is that possible? But captivated, I went with her, and she had read an account of how this young girl was going to die that day from overwhelming burn, sepsis. So we went to this hospital, and sure enough, there was this girl, what looked like a medieval cage. And this woman said to me, "Get me a helicopter." Now, how preposterous is that in a war zone to get a helicopter? But nonetheless, I walked out, and there was a U.S. Army weapons carrier there, and I said to the private, "I need a helicopter." Well, sure enough, a helicopter arrives, we evacuate this young girl, they go to the Cash Hospital, there I am in the picture, and with that, they saved her life. Now, this young woman advocated for civilians killed in conflict. There have been 101 million civilians killed in conflict in 271 wars, and the interesting thing is, in most wars, it's not a side effect, it's actually the policy. As the war fails for the warfighters, they target civilians and kill them in wars around the world. So she began this organization. Unfortunately, going down a road in Baghdad several years later, she was hit by a bomb. In her last words, "I've made it, I made it, I'm still alive." And she unfortunately gave her life to this cause, which I support today, which is called Civic. This is a raid early in the morning. We were always looking for entertainment in Baghdad, and we go out with the, this is the 82nd Airborne here. This is Colonel Nance. This is the world's most dangerous ocean channel. Here I am crossing it. You have 25-foot high waves, 37 knot winds. You get knocked off your board. The Wall Street Journal said, after you've done your Ironman, if you want to try something really challenging, try this. So around the world, I've always sought out the most dangerous things to possibly do. And of course, this had always been one of them, drinking coffee. When I was at CBS News and the NBC Evening News, we'd always were doing the next story on why coffee is dangerous for you. Now, the New England Journal of Medicine is kind of the Bible. It's the number one most important journal in the world today. And with lots of conflicting studies, it's the one that finally set the standard. And this seemed to be it. It says the risk of death is increased among coffee drinkers. But the advantage of this study was they had 5 million consumer years of coffee drinking. And as they went through there, they found out that that coffee wasn't the cause. It was a marker for bad behavior. So people drank coffee, they smoked more cigarettes, they drank more alcoholic drinks, they had more red meat, they had lower consumption of fruits and vegetables, less physical activity, and they had a lower level of education, which is why you rarely see it drunk in the dining hall here at Eaglebrook. So the astonishing fact was that coffee actually turned out to be spectacularly healthy. Here the New England Journal of Medicine came out and showed you take, it's kind of a funny term, but they call it all-cause death, but it's the ultimate metric. Just like the speedometer car, the metric of human health is decreasing all-cause death. So with coffee drinking, they found that the clean cohort, that is those that had no risk factors, like smoking and drinking and overeating, actually had a 15% decrease in all-cause death for women and a 10% decrease in all-cause death for men, which is astonishing because as a doctor, there's no medicine, no operation, there's nothing I can give you that will give you that kind of decrease in all-cause death. Now, the World Health Organization for years had said coffee causes cancer. We think it causes this and that and this and that, back and forth, and finally a couple of years ago, they came out and said, well, we don't think it causes any cancers, and we think it may actually prevent a couple of cancers. The Harvard School of Public Health has done several studies on depression, and they showed for women having 4 to 5 cups of coffee a day, there was a 20% decrease in the risk of depression. And then finally, there is the U.S. government seal of approval. So if you're caught in your room coughing, drinking coffee, you can say this is government recommended. They say there's a reduced risk of type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease. So, question, why is coffee so good for you? You want to answer the question? Alistair, why?
Polyphenols.
Yes! Polyphenols from a kindergartner. Thank you very much. So, we are a toxic inflammatory mess. I was with the vice chair of psychiatry at Massachusetts General Hospital, who heads the research program there. I was giving a talk for him at the Harvard Club a couple years ago, and he took me aside and he says, Bob, the average American is an inflammatory mess inside. Overweight, the wrong food, smoking, drinking, all of that. And so that inflammation gets into our lungs to cause asthma, gets into our hearts to cause heart disease, gets into our brain to cause depression, and we walk around with this massive amount of inflammation. So you would want an anti-inflammatory compound, and the most powerful anti-inflammatory compounds in the diet are called polyphenols. And those are found in fruits, vegetables, green tea, red wine, olive oil, and in coffee. Now, I got a call a few months ago from a professor that I've done some research projects with. He says, Bob, I'm sending you a paper. It's the most important paper you're ever going to read. And what it said was that the individuals who had the very highest polyphenol intake had the lowest overall risk of death. You can see here the lowest intake in red, intermediate in orange, and the highest intake green, the very lowest all-cause mortality. So the natural question is, where do I get my polyphenols? You want to try to answer? Well, black chokeberries, blueberries, blackberries, fruits, vegetables, and whatnot. But we thought we could get the very highest amount out of a coffee. So this is creating the ultimate super drink, the ultimate most important beverage food you could possibly consume, and we are calling that a super coffee. So what I did over a number of years was to look at coffee beans all around the world. And very much like wines, they're what we call varietals. They're particularly species that are better than another. And the British back in the 1930s hired Scott Labs to find the very best coffee beans. So the very best is called an SL28, taken by the French Holy Ghost priests in 1903 from Reunion Island to Kenya, where it grew. But it isn't, of course, just the varietal, it's the terroir. Where are you growing it? So what's interesting is that you're going to find that 50% of coffee disappears over the next 20 or 30 years, the low-altitude coffees with global warming. You've seen the tremendous crisis in Latin America as people stream up towards our borders. You can't blame many of them because with global warming, it's destroyed their livelihoods, including the production of coffee. So the very, very best coffee beans are grown in these amazing farms in East Africa. So they're cold, rainy, high-altitude, high-ionizing radiation. And what does that do? It stimulates the coffee bean to produce more and more and more polyphenols to make itself healthy. So we chose these beans out of thousands around the world. Then we established a very high freshness and intensity scores using analytical chemistry, actually what's called a gas chromatograph mass spectrometer. And the key step was roast. Now, what do you think the more healthy coffee is, light roast or dark roast?
Light
roast. Yes! That's right. How did you know that? But it's true. It's a light roast. The reason is that as you roast coffees, you're destroying the polyphenols. So the darker it is, the more polyphenols you destroy. Now, many people prefer the darker coffees, and we looked into that with our gas spectrometer. And it turns out that the dark flavors are more robust. So during travel or in a bag or leaving around the kitchen, that flavor will persist, and it is the flavor basically of burnt charcoal. In fact, we took a very popular coffee, sent it off to a lab, and they came back and they said, tastes like burnt wood with hints of petroleum. So, you know, I think it's particularly good. But the lighter roasts have spectacular flavors. In fact, there are more flavors in a light roasted coffee than there are in red wines. And there are now wine stewards who become coffee stewards because of the tremendous taste. But the key here is that we don't roast it too much. And with this, we've created a super coffee that is... On the left-hand side, you can see coffees that we have up to 20,000 of these particular polyphenols. You see many other popular brands that you may have drunk that are sort of littered by the wayside along the rest of that graph there. And we get the very highest marks on coffeereview.com. And again, here we have tremendous tastes. So, you know, many times people will come out and they'll say, you know, here's a medicine and it does such and such. It's what you call an intermediate marker. So when they first had statins for high cholesterol, you could lower the cholesterol, but the question is, does it do anything? Does it matter that you're lowering the cholesterol? 5 years later, they were able to show that you did decrease the risk of heart attacks. So it's the same thing here. Once we created the super cough, we said, well, we've got to be able to show that it actually does something, that actually has a human benefit. And in medicine, the double-blind, placebo-controlled crossover trial is the test. And by double-blind, that means you have an A group and a B group, and neither knows what they're drinking. They don't know whether it's the high-test coffee or the low-test coffee. And it's a crossover in that they, a couple weeks later, crossover, so they get to try the coffee in the other group. And that way, you get the best possible result. And so what we were able to show was that after 2 weeks of having one of these super coffees, there was a robust improvement in mood. And this was with the same instrument that is used at Harvard Medical School and Big Pharma to be able to prove that antidepressants work. So a very powerful instrument. And what's interesting about this is that we tested them after 2 weeks before they had their coffee in the morning. And what that meant was that the effect was the effect of the polyphenols and not the coffee. The next place here is with cycling. Jim had wanted me to sort of recall the beginning of this book. I have two books on coffee, one is which is called The Coffee Lover's Bible. And I was out in Kenya with all these 19 and 21-year-old Kenyans doing a 100-mile ride between about, I think, like 6 and 10,000 feet, just dying, trying to hang on to the end of the pack. And what they would do is they would stop and refuel with these super, super coffees. And so I was captivated by this idea and began to do some research on it. And now I and lots of athletes will actually take coffee before an endurance contest or first thing we get up in the morning. Why? Because what it does is it takes all of our free fatty acids to make them more mobile as a fuel. And then the caffeine itself has a tremendous effect. So in one study that was done in Birmingham, England, with the caffeine part of coffees, they were able to show that there was a tremendous improvement in power and endurance in cyclists drinking coffee. So we have an improvement in mood, we have an improvement in endurance and power and strength, but the key thing, of course, has to do is what about an improvement in overall health? So just a little aside here, and that is many people will want to ask, well, what's the perfect cup of coffee? And the answer is that it's an East African bean, like an Ethiopian Hambella or a Kenya Karagodo. It's a very light roast. The temperature is boiling. The grind is ultra fine, and the brew would be, Turkish would be the very best. In fact, I've done a bunch of Dr. Oz shows this year, and he was very pleased to hear there was Turkish coffee that was the best, or the Kalita, and that will give you the finest cup of coffee. But I had tried these coffees with a test called endothelial cell function. So it turns out that, I think, are we missing a slide here? Well, I'll make it up. There was a wonderful slide in here which had to do, which was called The Place Where People Forgot to Die. It was Ikaria Island in Greece. And Ikaria Island is one of, oh, six or seven places around the world where there are many, many more people who make it to 90 and 100 than other places. So listen to that wonderful talk on Tao medicine. And in fact, in the Far East, there are several of these communities where people tend to live a very, very long time. But the most intriguing thing about this island is people did everything right. They had the right genetics. They were relaxed. They walked up and down these big hills. They had a great diet. But those individuals who had the most coffee had the very best cardiovascular function. We've done testing on that, too, to show that it improves cardiovascular function. So finally, you'd say to yourself, well, nice, Dr. Danger, but what's a doctor doing messing around with coffee? So I'll tell you a little story. I've had, you know, many, many wonderful heroes that I've been able to observe all around the world. And one of my favorite was a young woman named Mickey Richard. So Mickey once had been in a community in Sudan, and she had a young mother who had twins she was trying to deliver, but it was a breached delivery, meaning that the children were sideways to the birth canal. It couldn't pass through without a surgeon doing a cesarean section. And so in the middle of the night, she takes this mother, puts her in a truck, goes to the Nile River, gets to the Nile River. There's no boatman. It's about a quarter of a mile across. It's dangerous. It's dark. There are dead animals floating there. So, of course, she gets in the river, swims across the river, gets the boatman, comes back over, puts the mother in the boat, takes her back over, asks for a car. They say, you can't have a car because there are no lights. Everybody is blind at night. You're going to get killed. Nonetheless, gets the car and saves the baby. But my favorite story with Mickey Richer, again, a mild-mannered 54-year-old, a Denver pediatrician, was in Somalia during the famine there. We were in the city of Baidoa, which was called the City of Death. Thousands of children dying every day. And these wonderful medical volunteers from International Medical Corps really risking their lives every day to save these children. So we were in their compound, and we heard rocket-propelled grenade fire down in the local marketplace. So we rushed down to the marketplace, and sure enough, there were 54 badly injured women and children. We scooped them up, put them in the backs of trucks, blood every place, took them back to the emergency room there. Several of them died almost immediately, unable to help them. But one of them was a 4.5-year-old girl named Aisha, cold, pale, sweaty, thin, thready pulse, very fast respirations, clearly not going to make it without blood, but there was no blood bank. So Mickey turns to this technician who she nicknamed, Vampire, who came over, took an IV, put it in her arm. She took a pint and a half of her own blood out, transfused it into this little girl, and with that saved her life, which really is my motto in medicine, that is, medicine should always be the very, very best result for the patient. So having worked with many groups, Doctors Without Borders in the Kibumba camp during the Rwanda genocide, International Medical Corps of many different places around the world, now on the board of Global Outreach Doctors, I'll be going off to Gender-Based Violence Hospital in the Congo during the summer. I'm medical director for a group in Iraq. We're trying to raise money to restore the Christian communities destroyed by ISIS. I'm on the board with Sean Penn and Ben Stiller of a hospital and a school down in Haiti, where we have the poorest of the poor come to a lovely school, very much like Eaglebrook, except these children, their qualification is they have absolutely nothing to go. So the trouble, though, with the whole international movement here, and we heard this wonderful talk about sort of global distribution of wealth, is it's not sustainable. In the end, we can't have Mickey Richer stay there, you know, for 5 years in Baidoa. We save the children, we can go in community for 2 or 3 years, but we can't sustain it after that. And that's the beauty of coffee. that is, with these beans that we have for super coffee, they're expensive. They're $4, $5, or $6 for a pound of this coffee. But we make sure that that money is going back to the farmer. And what that means is the farmer then has the ability to buy health care, to be able to provide an education for his children for generations to come, as opposed to just 2 or 3 years. In fact, I mentioned Hambella is one of the very best coffee beans. The Hambella farm is all female run. It was donated by the Emperor of Haile Selassie during World War II to the first female Ethiopian fighter pilot. So just a wonderful story. But with this, you do have the opportunity to save the world in a couple of ways. One, it's a wonderful way to sort of soak up carbon dioxide. So if you have these tree-shaded farms, rather than leaving it barren or stripping it, you have an ability to be able to suck up carbon dioxide, and a tremendous ability to really save the world by providing sustainability. And as you think in terms of global politics, one of the most important things for us to do is to be able to sustain these communities so that they are allies of ours. I mean, Kenya, as an example, has been sort of on the fence. You have, you know, terrorists coming up, you know, down from Somalia, you have terrorism along the coast. You know, it's a country that could go either way. But with coffee and with tea production out there, you have tremendous income there. You have the real opportunity that we can save these lives. So one of the greatest things I love about Eaglebrook is there is this tremendous sort of mission that we all want to do great things for the world. And I want to thank Jim again for organizing such a wonderful conference, Emmy, for your wonderful family there, and of course to my wonderful friends, Rachel, Andy, Lucy, and Sam. Thank you very much.